10 o'clock. Good morning. Let us gather ourselves in, all you all in the narthex. Gather ourselves in. Welcome, welcome to here. This is First Lutheran Church. We welcome you to this time. We welcome you to this moment. We understand that, we believe here that we don't think of ourselves as members or visitors, just people called to this moment by the Holy Spirit, or maybe a baptism, I don't know. And why can't it all be the same thing? So we welcome you to this moment. Just some notes. We like to practice what we jokingly call liturgical aerobics. So there's a lot of standing up and a lot of sitting down. If that's the struggle for you, or if you just don't want to do it, please do not feel obligated to do it. All are welcome to join us at our Lord's meal, and we mean that. We do have gluten-free and alcohol-free alternatives, if that should be an issue. And you just, if this is your first time and that is something you want, you need to just give me a little, hey, I want the gluten, and so we can provide that for you. I will point you to the bulletin for all upcoming announcements as far as meetings and all that stuff. We do have a few joys and concerns. Felix is getting baptized. Yeah. He heard his name. You know, and just so we can reflect back, so if you don't know this, Amanda is the director of congregational life in this congregation. And we, in the trials and tribulations of Kevin, so we are so happy. Ooh, I'm getting teary all of a sudden. We're so happy about this, you know, where we were 4 months ago. So what a celebration. Sorry, I don't know why that caught me. That just caught me off guard. So we welcome, we're happy about that. As far as joys and concerns, we've been a relatively healthy congregation this week. I can't think of anybody that has been in the hospital. We continue to keep those folks we have in our prayer list on our prayer list. Please pray for them. We do have another joy, and today is Bob. It's his birthday. So. Another rotation around the sun. Congratulations. I can't think of any. Does anybody have an announcement that wasn't in the bulletin or a joy and concern that we need to address? Anyone? Anyone? Bueller? Anyone? Yes. Thank you. After COVID, we had Christmas dinner. We pulled it off, but barely. And so Bill is taking upon himself to help organize the men better. So please, if you're a man, if you can see him, so we can know what we're doing for the Christmas time. Plus, the men's group in general needs to get back together. So thank you for that. Anything else? Anyone? If not, then let's take this moment with our prelude as we prepare to come into our Lord's presence. Please stand as you are able. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who greets us in this and every season, whose word never fails, whose promise is sure. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of our neighbors. Righteous God, God is a cup of cold water when we thirst. God offers boundless grace when we fail. Claim the gift of God's mercy. You are freed and forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
For peace in the world, for the health of the church, for the unity of all. For this holy house, for all who worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. that we may live out your impatient response to the hungry and the poor. That we may live out truth and justice and grace, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For peace in our hearts, for peace in our homes, for friends and family. For life and for love, for our work and our play, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord. For your Spirit to guide, that you center our lives in the water and the word, that you nourish our soul with your body and blood, let us pray to the Lord. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord be with you. Let us pray. O God, with all your faithful followers of every age, we praise you, the rock of our life. Be our strong foundation from us and form us into the body of your Son, that we may gladly minister to all the world. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Please be seated. Can the children invited to come forward? Where is everybody? How are you? Is Simon coming? Oh, here we go. There he is. Oh, boy. Got to see who we know as we come down the... That's fine. Hey, come on forward. Here, come with me. Let's come up here. Good morning. Good to see y'all. Hey, good to see you, Simon. Hey, I'm Pastor Matt. No, I'm not. Mateo. I have a Matthias. Welcome, Mateo. I don't mean to embarrass you. Okay, so I'm going to ask you right now to point to the church. What are you pointing at? What are you pointing at, Salmon? The floor. Right. You know what? I would bet if I asked all of them, they would point to the floor too, or they might point to the ceiling. Do you know what we think the church is? What do we think the church is? It's a, yeah, glass, right? All that stuff. Organs, chairs. Right? It's okay. He's fine. Right? Let me tell you where the church is. So we're going to hear about this guy. His name is Peter. Well, his first name was Simon, but Jesus is going to give him a new name, and that new name is Peter, and it comes from a Greek word, which means Petros. Have you ever studied what happens to wood if over time, what does it turn into? Stone. You know what they call that? Petrification. Right? So Peter is the rock that Jesus is going to build the church upon. So do you think they're really going to take Peter and they're going to lay him down and then they're going to pour concrete on top of him? Do you think that's what they're going to do? You think that's what Jesus meant? No. You want me to point? Let's think about maybe it's what Peter says. He calls Jesus the Messiah, the Son of the living God. So instead of pointing at the floor, or pointing at the ceiling, or pointing at the windows, why don't we point at the people? The church is not this building, as pretty as it is. You know who the church is? You. And you and you and all of them. So I'm going to teach you something have you ever seen this? You know, here's the church, here's the steeple, open this door and see all the people. You've never seen that before? What? Your mom is the director of congregational life. But you know why it's good she didn't teach it to you? Because guess what? It's wrong. Right? It's wrong. This is the building, and this is the steeple, and open the door and see the church. Right? The people, this is the church. This beautiful place could just all go away. And you know what they would do? They would just build another one because the church is those people. So let's point to the church. Ready? Point to the church. Point to yourself. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we give you this thanks this day that you remind us that you build your future, you build our future, you build our hope upon us, the church. Dear Lord, give us the ability to let the world see you through us. We pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
A reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, you that pursue righteousness, you that seek the Lord. Look to the rock from which you were hewn, and to the quarry from which you were dug. Look to Abraham your father, and to Sarah who bore you. For he was but one when I called him, but I blessed him and made him many. For the Lord will comfort Zion. He will comfort all her waste places, and will make her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of the Lord. Joy and gladness will be found in her, thanksgiving and the voice of song. Listen to me, my people, and give me heed, my nation, for a teaching will go out from me, and my justice for a light to all peoples. I will bring near my deliverance swiftly. My salvation has gone out, and my arms will rule the peoples. The coastlands wait for me, and my arm they hope. Lift up your eyes to the heavens and look at the earth beneath. For the heavens will vanish like smoke. The earth will wear out like a garment, and those who live on it will die like gnats. But my salvation will be forever, and my deliverance will never be ended. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A psalm to be read responsively. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, and with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. When I called, you answered me. You increased my strength within me. They will sing the ways of the Lord. That great is the glory of the Lord. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me. A reading from Romans. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given me, I say to everyone among you who did not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. As one body, we have many members, and not all the members have the same function. So we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members of one another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness, the word of the Lord.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, but others Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." And he said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered him, "Blessed are you, Simon of Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but the Father in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail against it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, And wherever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. Then he sternly ordered his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. The gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. So we don't avoid politics in the Gospels, right? So we'll start at the end. Why do you think Jesus tells them not to tell people what Peter just said? In light of the empire, where Caesar is Lord, Caesar is the Son of God, right? Don't tell anybody, because if you do, you're going to get me killed, right? So you have to understand the weight of the political implications of this text. They're at Caesarea Philippi. I remind you, we look at Scripture in different ways. And one way, we look at historical, critical, what's going on at the time. But we also look at the narrative. Why did the writer write it this way? And we can make educated guesses. But there's a tool that is in the Gospel of Luke. And Jesus passes over the sea. He goes from one side to the other and back again. And that's a theme in the Gospel of Matthew. On one side of the sea is home, is Jerusalem. On the other side of the sea is a strange world, right? Where people don't do it like we do. You know, they eat pork barbecue over there. You think I'm kidding? That's part of the, all of us Lexingtonians love our barbecue, right? And so what Jesus has done is he's crossed over, and we've been doing the Gospel of Matthew all year now, right? So we've heard this back and forth when Jesus is with his people, and now Jesus is in a strange land, and it's about as strange as you get. He is at Caesarea Philippi. He is in the Gentilest of the Gentilest places. It is the most culturally, religiously diverse as you can get during this time, right? And they're standing in the midst of this, in the midst of empire. And it's at this point that Jesus asks, "But who do you say that I am?" Now it's interesting, the disciples are all Jewish, right? They're all Jewish. So they give very Jewish answers, and that is, you are one of the prophets. Or some say you are the reincarnation of John the Baptist, which is sort of a strange one to come up with. But in the midst of this diverse thing, the question is, but who do you guys, you 12, say that I am? And who speaks up? It's Peter. And let's think of the narrative of who Peter is. I remind you of several sermons back. Peter, Petros, Simon, Peter, Petros, the rock, on you I will build my church. What did we hear two Sundays ago coming out of Jesus' mouth? Simon, Peter, you of little faith, why do you doubt? And what is Simon doing when Jesus says that to him? He's sinking into the sea. Remember, Jesus is walking on the water. The irony of it, right? You're the rock in which the church is built, is also the rock that's sinking like a stone. You got to hold that narrative in your head. Who is it that gets the proclamation of Jesus right? Remember, it's the Canaanite woman who Jesus said the ugly thing to, called her a dog, yet she persists. What does he say to the Canaanite woman? You of great faith. And then now Peter's going to stand up, Stand up and represent the church and say, you are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God. Not Caesar, it's you. It's you. In this foreign place, it's you. And Jesus is all happy, on you I will build my church. But then what does he make sure Peter knows? You did not come to this by your own conclusion or your own power. It is the Father that wants you to know this. Right? I joke, for all of you who are not from First, I always jokingly tell the people of First, we became members of First, we became Lutheran because we were just so much smarter than everybody else. Right? Thank goodness we're not Methodist. Is that really how we became Lutherans? I was sort of born into it. What about y'all? Right? Or, here's the big one. Some of you married into it. That's the joke. That's how we birth them, we marry them. That's what we call evangelism. Right? What brought us to this moment? What always brings us to this moment? Is it because we're smarter than everybody else? Right? It's not. It is not. And that's what Jesus wants Peter to know. It's the Father that brought you to this moment. You just got it right. Out of all the times you've gotten it wrong, thank you, Jesus, or I guess he would say, thank me, you got it right. Right? You got it right. You're right. Because the reality of faith is this is not about doctrine. This is not about denomination. This is not about whatever. This is about Jesus, right? Every sermon I preach, I can do in a children's sermon. It's always about Jesus. I look at the kids and say, what is love? It's Jesus. What is hope? It's Jesus. What is faith? Trust in Jesus. Right? And I don't think Simon is somehow divined. I've followed you around and I've looked at the stars and I've read the scriptures and you're the guy. Because what's really strange about this is he calls him the Messiah. And that Jesus really doesn't act a lot like? Doesn't act a lot like a Messiah. These aren't like the Messiahs of old. I don't see any swords or armies. Right? It's a weird kind of Messiah that Jesus is. As a matter of fact, it gets even weirder because what happens to this Messiah? He dies. And then he rises again. It feels a lot like last Sunday's sermon, but I can't use that illustration again. This feels like we have all of our wonderful thoughts, and here's Socrates, and here is Plato, and here's the Babylonian gods, and here is the Jewish understanding of God. We have all that, but sometimes we're forced to, what do I have? What's it all about? And that's what Simon is facing before he becomes Peter. What you got? What do you have? And we actually sang it before we read the gospel. Alleluia. Lord, to whom shall we go? What else do we have? Right? All of the complexities of life. We're going to sing Born and Cry, and we're all going to get, because it makes us a little sad. Right? When we were born, what did we have? You know, when we fell in love, what did we have? When our children were born, what do we have? When we face all of the confusion of life, what do we have? When we face our death, what do we have? Lord, to whom shall we go? You're all we got. And that's kind of what Peter is saying. You're it. You're it. But when we can confess that, right? When we confess that, that's all we need, right? I do this all the time for y'all who are here. I always quote the Rolling Stones. You can't always get what you want, but when you try sometimes, you just might find you get what you need, right? That's basically what Peter is saying. Peter is standing in front of the world. You know, this is the world. This is as big as the world gets in the Gospels, at Caesarea Philippi. And says, in the midst of this, all I got is you, Jesus. That sounds desperate, but it's not. It is our joy. It is our hope. It is our salvation. We'll face all the questions of the world, right? And guess what? Most of the time, the best answer to those questions is, I don't know. But I got Jesus. So we're going to baptize this child, Felix. And what are we really doing? This is not the magic ceremony to get Felix into heaven. That's not what we're doing. There's no magic in this room. Why do we do this? It's to begin his journey. And that journey is being baptized, growing up, falling in love, having a family, mourning the death of people he loves, one day facing his own death. And what do we remind him in baptism? In our tradition, we call this nurturing of baptism. We spend his lifetime saying the same thing over and over that we say in the children's sermon. He's going to hear it every Sunday when he comes here, and that is, Felix, you are a child of God. You are a child of God. As Christ was baptized, so are you baptized. As Christ died, so too you will die. As Christ rose again, so too will you. Right? And in the end, with all of the confusion and all of the realities of life, you got that. Hold on to that. Be that. That's the good news. That is the good news, right? This life is not about, you know, you win some, you lose some. But in the end, right, in the end, you win. You win. That's this moment. And that is what the church is built on. The church is not built on the thing, you know, pretty buildings or fancy preachers or great organist. I have to take at least one jab. Right? What is the church built upon? Right? It's built upon our confession of our Lord and Savior. And it's built upon us. It's on us. We are the rock. And if they don't see it through you, who are they going to see it through? So let us rejoice and be glad as we baptize this child and as we remember for our baptisms, and know that we are loved. Amen. Oh, baptisms. God, who is rich in mercy and love, gives us a new birth into a living hope. Through the sacrament of baptism, by water and the word, God delivers us from sin and death and raises us to new life in Jesus Christ. We are united with all the baptized in the one body of Christ, anointed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and join in God's mission for the life of the world. Kevin and Amanda, called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your son baptized in Christ? Respond by saying, "We do." And I will ask all y'all, I'll ask all the godparents and the parents, as you come to bring Felix to receive the gift of baptism, you are entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, to bring him to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach him the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in his hands the Holy Scriptures, and to nurture him in faith and prayer, so that he may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others and the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help Felix grow in Christian faith and love? Respond by saying, "We do." Do you promise to nurture Felix in Christian faith as you are empowered by God's Spirit and to help him live in the covenant of baptism and in the communion of the church? Respond by saying, "We do." Yeah. People of God who are all gathered here, do you promise to support Felix and to pray for him in his life in Christ?
Amen.
People of God, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, reject sin, and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the power of this world that rebels against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? I renounce. Do you believe in God the Father?
I believe in God the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God?
I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of the Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. Do you believe in God, the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
With you. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, O God, maker and ruler of all things. Your voice thundered over the waters of creation. You water the mountains and send springs into the valleys to refresh and satisfy all living things. Through the waters of the flood, you carried those in the ark to safety. Through the sea, you led your people Israel from slavery to freedom. In the wilderness, you nourished them with water from the rock, and you brought them across the River Jordan to the promised land. By the baptism of his death and resurrection, your son Jesus has carried us to the safety and freedom. The flood shall not overwhelm us, and the deep shall not swallow us up. For Christ has brought us over to the land of promise. He sends us to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Pour out your Holy Spirit. Wash away sin in this cleansing water. Clothe the baptized with Christ and claim your daughters and sons, no longer slave and free, no longer male and female, but one with all the baptized in Christ Jesus. who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Here we go. Oh, Felix. We're going to go. It's way down there. So, Felix, child of God, I baptize you in the name of the Father. Ooh, I know. And of the Son. Oh, you want to see? Here, you can see. And of the Holy Spirit. Yeah, I'd want to see too. He likes the water. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your sons and daughters new birth. Cleanse them from sin and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Felix with the gift of your Holy Spirit and of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy, both now and forever. Felix, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. You can touch that too. Just got to touch it. That's fine. I'll give you. Let your light shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Let us welcome the newly baptized. These are your brothers and sisters in Christ. They are to pray for you, and they are to nourish you in your baptism as you grow. Your mom's going to be here to help you with that, because that's her job. They are fellow workers with you in the fields, and you are to be the same for them. So let's get a good look.
Confident that God receives our joys and concerns, let us offer our prayers for the church, those in need, and all of creation. God of Sarah and Abraham, inspire your church to pursue righteousness in its ministry. Equip us to share your compassion that unites us as one family of faith. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Remind us that from the beginning of creation, you knit together a world meant for harmony. Protect and restore the wasted places to joy and gladness. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Stir the leaders of nations and towns, militaries and courts, to respond to your teachings. Let your call for justice and peace reach all people and bring deliverance where there is oppression, disaster, tragedy, or injustice. We especially continue to pray for Hawaii and the Ukraine. Hear us, O God. Encourage those who offer their gifts and talents in service to your church. Energize Pastor Matt, Kelly, Amanda, myself, lay leaders, musicians, teachers, and greeters, so they may be transformed in sharing your grace. Hear us, O God. Show your steadfast love and faithfulness to those in despair. Increase their strength. Care for all who feel low. Keep safe any in the midst of trouble. And protect vulnerable people from harm. We especially pray for Ronnie and Rebecca, Phil, Kevin and Dan, Bishop Tim, his wife Wendy, and the Synod staff. Laura, Luetta, Roy and Gracie, Vicky, Lee, Willie Ruth, Pauletta, and Anne. Be with all those on our prayer list, for those we name silently in our hearts or for those we now name aloud. Hear us, O God. God of all saints, death is overcome in Christ's resurrection. We rejoice with the faithful departed. Sustain us in hope until we come at last to our heavenly home. Hear us, O God. Mercy is great.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in the name of the one who reconciled all creation to himself, Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us give thanks as we share peace with one another.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God of fields and forests, sea and sky,
the Lord be with you.
And also
lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It
is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection, opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so, with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks. He broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took a cup. And after giving thanks, he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this Holy Communion we may know the unity we share with all your people in the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Remember us in your kingdom, O God, and teach us to pray.
Thank you.
people are called to Christ's table. Come, eat what is good.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the gift of his body and blood strengthen, keep, and unite us now and forever. Amen.
Let us pray. We thank you, generous God, for the refreshment we have received at your banquet table. Eternal God, whose glory is revealed in the crucified and risen Lord, bless those who go forth to share your word and sacrament with our sisters and brothers who are unable to be with us today. In your love and care, nourish and strengthen those to whom we bring this communion in the body and blood of your Son, that we may all feast upon your abundant love made known in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. The God who calls across the cosmos and speaks in the smallest seed, bless, keep, and sustain you now and to the end of the age. Amen. Thank you. celebrate this day, the family has provided a meal after church, and anybody here is invited. So please, you just go straight down there. You can take the elevator, or you can take the stairs down, and please join us for the meal. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we give you thanks for the nourishment of food that you have nourished us through this holy meal, and now you nourish us through this lunch. Dear Lord, we gather and we celebrate a day as we welcome another into the body of Christ. We give you thanks for Felix. Bless this food, nourish our bodies, bless our time of fellowship. We pray these things in your holy name. Amen.
Go in peace to serve the Lord.